Maybe 26 years later, but still the confusion. I'm on a broadcast platform here. Mexican, Spanish television, German, Austrian. They're reporting blanco, blanco, white, white. We have not heard the bells, obviously. Maybe they're taking time to ring, or once again, the confusion that we had yesterday is spilling over into today. Nonetheless, the crowds here, numbering in the tens of thousands, are ready to hear the name of their new pope. They're convinced it's white, and we'll have to see who can sort out this confusion. I guess, Brian, really, we're going to have to wait until we hear those bells or definitive black smoke. At the moment, we clearly have some confusion there.
A copious amount of smoke, whatever the case. We came on the air, I guess, around 8 minutes of noon Eastern time, and I should read you Associated Press out of the Vatican is reporting, quote, the dark smoke, which also emerged from the chapel slender stovepipe after two inconclusive morning ballots, meant the cardinals would have to try again Wednesday. So some news organizations characterizing this as dark, while, as Keith Miller reports, others on the scene and able to see it, especially with the advantage, as we have, of long-distance television lenses, are calling this either white or light smoke. And as Keith Miller mentioned, it was following the election of Karol Wojtyła of Poland, before we knew we had a new pope, that the smoke can only be characterized at that time as a gray in color. Steps have been taken since then to reduce the confusion, among them the sounding of the seven Vatican bells. We are watching the bell there in the small screen on the left hand of your picture, and it has remained thus far still. But clearly, the crowd has voted, and I'm being told that Vatican Radio is changing its reporting to say the smoke, quote, appears white. They have gone from black to white. All of this, for the witnesses there, for the pilgrims gathered in St. Peter's Square, and you see them there, thousands of them, all of this part of the very, very exciting atmosphere surrounding this. Father Williams, you're watching this as well as we wait for either a wave-off or a confirmation. And again, huge amounts of smoke come from this stovepipe, which was installed for the occasion out the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. Father, it's clear the crowd has made its own judgment.
Well, that's true, Brian, and I think they may very well be right. I think we may have a pope here. Those of us who are watching, we see definitely what looks like a light-colored smoke. The only thing is, we were promised the confirmation of the bells, which hasn't been forthcoming, so we're all just kind of in restless anxiety here. But every indication is that the smoke is white, and also the hour of the day, as George Weigel mentioned a little bit earlier, would clearly suggest that there was only one ballot. So we just have to wait for a moment now and see if this isn't confirmed by the Vatican bells.
Keith Miller, we're hearing reports of a surge of more people into the square.
Bells or no bells, Brian, the people are rushing here to St. Peter's Square. The word has gone out that it is white smoke, certainly within this area of Rome, and they are coming into the square. I can see them moving across the streets here. They block traffic to allow the crowds to move around here safely. We're still waiting for the bells, but I don't think the people care much. It's interesting, Brian, they want a pope, and they want him now. And I think just the idea that it may be gray smoke or blue smoke or whatever, they're here ready to hear the name of the new pope, and they're still arriving now, hoping to hear the bells to confirm what color we're seeing of the smoke.
And I should caution everybody, coming up in about 2 minutes is the regular ringing of the bells on the hour. Having just returned from there, they are, as they say, like clockwork. They dependably ring on the hour and half. So we could hear unrelated bells, but the smoke now being characterized by two news organizations as either light or white in color. Others are hedging their bets.
Brian, it's Lester.
Go ahead.
Brian, we should point out this morning when we saw black smoke following the first session, about 10 or 15 minutes passed and we saw more black smoke. That wasn't part of anything we had been led to believe would happen, and there was confusion over that. We don't know why we saw a second round of black smoke several minutes after the first. So this kind of goes with a theme today in which things are happening in a way that we weren't led to expect they would.
Vatican Radio and, saying the color is hard to distinguish, Lester.
Yeah, it certainly looks whiter than what we saw. Yesterday, it began this color, and then the crowd erupted, much as you saw here. But then it took on that darker gray, and then we saw the black qualities. And this morning, it appeared very similar.
Noon in New York, 11 a.m. where we're joining you from our makeshift studios in Oklahoma City, where we are covering the 10th anniversary of the Oklahoma City bombing. Our NBC News team is standing by at the Vatican on a hilltop overlooking the chimney, which you're seeing via big screen TV in St. Peter's Square. Several national flags flying in the foreground and the background. And we can certainly report at this hour that a light-colored smoke is flowing in great amounts. And from the Sistine Chapel chimney, we are keeping a close eye on that bell, which the complication is it would normally be due to ring. There is a scheduled bell ringing at this hour. Among our on-air experts, our papal biographer George Weigel is with us. George, this seems like, given what we know about the stack of ballots strung together by thread that is thrown in, I guess, with an accelerant-like straw to create the fire, that seemed like more smoke than that would create. Is there something they use to increase the signal?
In addition to the ballots, Brian, and the chemical, which is supposed to clarify whether the smoke is in fact white or black, the cardinal scrutineers, the men who count the ballots and announce the votes in the Sistine Chapel, are to gather up all of the notes that the cardinal electors have taken during the voting session. Each one of them is, of course, keeping his own private score of the tally as it's read out aloud, vote by vote. And according to Pope John Paul II's Apostolic Constitution, which is governing all of these events, all of those notes are to be taken up and burned at the same time. That would make for a rather large amount of paper, I should think. The ballots, the notes, etc. It might be worth noting that this would be, by modern conclave standards, a rather early resolution of the conclave. In 1978, it took 2 days and four votes to elect Pope John Paul I. In 1939, there we see on the graphic, it took 2 days and three ballots to elect Pope Pius XII. Even in 1963, when Pope Paul VI, then Cardinal Giovanni Battista Montini of Milan, was elected and was the going away favorite going into the conclave, it took some 3 days and six ballots to reach a resolution. So this would be fast work, indicating a rapidly forming consensus among the cardinals last week, confirmed over a little more than a day of voting.
And the Reuters news agency still hedging its bet, saying smoke rose from the chimney on the roof of the Sistine Chapel on Tuesday, but the color was unclear and it was not immediately known whether a pope had been elected. They go on to point out, as we have been doing, that any true white smoke, a vote for a pope, would be accompanied by a ringing of the bells from the Vatican. This is still a live picture. Keith Miller continues to watch the people surging into St. Peter's as in these ancient twisting streets around Vatican City. Word among merchants and pilgrims alike spreads very quickly of activity in St. Peter's Square. Keith?
The bells have started.
We've got bells,
well,
friend.
Brian, I have to tell you, the mood here is absolutely electric. You've got people like absolutely convinced it's white smoke. There may be no bells, but they don't care. They're actually going and saying it's going. I think we've got the bells going now, Brian. We have a new pope. The first pope of the third millennium has been elected in the Sistine Chapel by the 115 cardinal electors. We shall hear his name fairly soon, I would think, Brian.
The bells are ringing at around 12:04 Eastern Time. You see the clock over the bells in the Vatican. All seven bells.
Who picked
proclaiming
it?
The news,
the
we
daddy?
Believe.
Who's the daddy?
Official.
Stand by. Go to the left.
A new pope has been chosen. Just joining our live NBC News coverage, you see the clock at 5 minutes after the hour of 6 p.m., that is the local time in Vatican City. Beneath the clock, the seven bells proclaiming the news, the election of a new head of the Catholic Church around the world. The biographer of the last pope, John Paul II, Karol Wojtyła of Poland, George Weigel, our NBC News Vatican analyst, is with us, and George, we can now begin the process of asking you to tell us what is going on, what's transpiring inside that building, and what will we see soon.
After the successful candidate vote tally was announced, Brian, either the Cardinal Dean or the Cardinal Subdean, if the Cardinal Dean, Cardinal Ratzinger, had been elected, went up to the successful victor, asked him in Latin, "Do you accept your election," which has been canonically carried out. After the answer yes was received, the question was then posed, by what name will you be known? That answer was then given. At that point, the new pope is taken into a small sacristy just to the bottom left of Michelangelo's Last Judgment in the Sistine Chapel, where three sets of white papal vestments have been prepared for some weeks by the Gamarelli brothers, an ancient tailoring firm here in Rome, large, medium, and small. The new pope is fitted in his new vestments. He goes back into the Sistine Chapel to receive the homage of his brother cardinals. This was the moment at which Pope John Paul II broke his first precedent. In 1978, he came out of the vesting room and was told to take a seat by one of the papal masters of ceremonies. John Paul II said, "I receive my brother's standing." After that homage of the cardinals, basically each one comes up in a processional line, shakes his hand. The senior cardinal deacon, Cardinal Arturo Jorge Medina Estevez of Chile, will come out to the window on the loggia of St. Peter's to announce Habemus Papam. We have a pope. He will then read the name in a Latin formula, which will say, "Cardinals have elected my most eminent and reverend lord, first name Cardinal, last name." who has then taken upon himself the name, and then he'll announce the new Pope's name as the Vicar of Christ and the successor of St. Peter. Some
and
moments
George,
after
I'll
that,
go ahead,
perhaps.
Go ahead, George, I'm sorry.
Sorry, Brian, I was just finishing up. Sometime after that, perhaps 10 or 15 minutes, judging by last time, the new Pope will make his appearance to give his first blessing to the city and the world.
And George, in this accelerated media age, we have seen so many startling firsts, among them the live television coverage from inside the Vatican. Is there reason to believe that this process, which could take 40 minutes to an hour until we get our first glimpse of the new Pope, is going to break precedent again and be accelerated once again?
Well, we certainly hope so, sitting here, Brian, and so do those tens of thousands of people down in the square. If, in fact, they waited to burn the ballots and the notes until sometime toward the end of the Cardinal's homage to the new Pope, that would shorten the process considerably. As we saw yesterday in the procession into the Sistine Chapel from the Hall of Benedictions, out from which that window opens onto St. Peter's Square, it's a very short distance, a couple of hundred yards through the Sala Regia of the Apostolic Palace and into the Hall of Benedictions and then up to the window.
Associated Press reporting at this hour, the bells above St. Peter's Square are ringing, confirming that a new pope has been elected. Crowds in the square are chanting, Viva il Papa, or Long Live the Pope. And George, here is where the announcement would be made. We're looking at the balcony. We will see any preparations made when the doors open. This selection has been made during the second session of the second day, and George, does anything about the timing, and we're delving into the realm of speculation here, does anything about this unusual timing indicate to you a favored candidate, one over another?
I think virtually everyone here, Brian, not just me, would say that the likely prospect is that Cardinal Ratzinger, who entered the conclave with what one cardinal described to me as a consensus of esteem behind him, would be the likeliest possibility for a quick resolution of the conclave. But we should always remember that there are surprises in this and that we don't know for sure until that name is proclaimed by Cardinal Medina Estevez. Were this to be Cardinal Ratzinger, there's an interesting coincidence. Today on the Roman Catholic liturgical calendar is the commemoration of Pope St. Leo IX, who was the last great German pope.
And that's why George Weigel is of counsel to us on our coverage of what is today the heralding of the election of a new pope, one of the electric moments of a lifetime. If you are a Catholic visiting St. Peter's Square, Keith Miller was reporting, after what certainly looked to us to be white smoke, that the word had gone forth throughout the tiny confines of Vatican City and the surrounding area of Rome. The people surged into the square, and now, because this is the way that was set up to notify the populace long before television, cable television, radio, cell phones, and pagers, this message will be received throughout the downtown area in Rome. Let's go back to Keith Miller, who had the initial call for us that we indeed had a new head of the Roman Catholic Church.
Brian, they are running, not walking, to St. Peter's Square. I can tell you dozens, well, not by the dozens, by the hundreds, they're arriving here. We're going to fill this square up. I would guess we're going to be up to 250,000 people will be here by the time they are going to announce the name of the new pope. People here very excited. It's been an electric atmosphere. The smoke, the confusion over the smoke has now been forgotten, although I would suspect that perhaps the next time they elect a pope, they may have bells, the smoke, and perhaps put in whistles or something else, because the confusion has been great and widespread. They may actually try to come up with another formula to be absolutely certain about this. But nonetheless, people arriving here by the hundreds, the whole city is now electrified over the idea that they will now have a pope. Brian, you were leading our coverage here 10 days ago or more when we had the passing of Pope John Paul II. We saw the square filled with people, almost 300,000 attending the funeral rites. Very sad, very sorrowful moment. Which you led us through. And now tonight, what we're going to see is the exact opposite, a very joyful crowd, very expectant. I'm not sure that they're hoping for one pope or another, whether it be Ratzinger, who we've been talking about all week, or perhaps a Latin American cardinal. What they just want, a pope. They want somebody to lead this church into and through the third millennium, and that's what they're going to get. And I think they'll applaud and be pleased without perhaps any name that comes up here. That's the level of the excitement here. Just the idea that the cardinals have come to a conclusion, and now we're going to hear the name of the pope at some point in the very near future here. Brian?
And Keith, as you spoke, some of the high shots we were looking at, people are seeing streaming down the streets. There's a breach in at least one police barricade as they are pressing their way through. They're not going to take no for an answer. It looks like Vatican police have insisted upon one rectangular safe zone in the middle of St. Peter's Square where there are no people, but other than that, they have filled in every available space. And we will keep such a close eye on the balcony, the sheer curtains at the door for the first sign of activity. Again, in this situation where the news media, after all, were notified of the death of Pope John Paul II via the very high-tech delivery system of email, there is every reason to believe that something about this announcement could be accelerated and thus precedent setting. NBC News correspondent Jim Maceda is among the people on the square in St. Peter's. Jim?
Hi there, Brian. Well, a remarkable experience here, right in the middle of the square, right next to the giant obelisk behind me, surrounded now by tens upon tens of thousands of people. They have, as you say, been streaming into this gigantic square. Once they heard the news that these bells were not bells for the 6 o'clock hour, but indeed bells to announce a new pope. The mood here is upbeat. It is one of expectation, but I've got to say there are many more smiles than tears. A lot of digital cameras, a lot of children with their families, also a lot of sisters in habits. There's a tremendous amount of sacerdotal presence here, of Catholic presence here, but it is just an extraordinary group of people, young and old, who have come waiting now for one word only, and that is, who is the new pope? That is the big question. We do know that 40 to 45 minutes, Brian, from the time of the acceptance of that new position, the pope will come behind me to that loggia, which is curtained in red, the papal loggia. He will make an appearance with the senior cardinal deacon, who will say in Latin, of course, "I announce to you news of great joy. We have a new pope, Habemus Papam." Then the pope will give his blessing to these people. There should be tumultuous excitement and applause. If you recall, back in October of 1978, John Paul II took the opportunity to excuse his Italian at the time, so there may be some kind of improvised statement or two. Then later, after a blessing, there probably will be some kind of dinner at St. Martin's Hotel with all of the cardinals, even those over 80 years old, with the new pope. And then finally, that installation mass at the discretion of the new pope. Pope John Paul had it 6 days after his announcement, his acceptance of the position. So it could be that long as well. But that's generally what these people know by heart, and that's why they're here right now. Brian?
And Jim, while you've been talking, we have seen the first slight ruffling of the curtain behind the door. And in this business where we are trying to pick up on whatever clues are available to us, it would indicate either the room behind those curtains is occupied or a door has been opened, breaking the airlock. But I think it's safe to assume that there are people just behind the curtains that we could see. We could see very shortly the opening of those huge French doors, the balcony that Romans know so very well, that will carry the announcement of the new Pope. And George Weigel, I think it's a good time for you to, in your best Latin, walk us through the wording we will hear and tell us precisely where we will hear embedded in that the name of the new Pope, which you will at the time, I hope, help us with and blurt out when you hear it.
Brian, with hopes that my high school Latin teachers are not listening too carefully, the formula is as follows: Annuncio vobis gaudium magnum habemus papam, eminentissimum ac reverendissimum dominum, first name, Sancte Romani Ecclesiae Cardinalem, last name, qui sibi nomen imposuit, papal name. So I announce to you a great joy. We have a Pope, the most eminent and reverend Lord, first name, Cardinal of the Holy Roman Church, last name, who has taken upon himself the name, papal name.
Okay, and not to put too fine a point on it, George, so the words, the key words we're listening for are dominum blank, in effect, cardinum
and
blank,
cardinalem,
and what is the last one?
Imposuit,
okay.
Who is cardinalem blank, that gets you the last name, and then imposuit has taken upon himself the name blank. That's at the very end of the formula that we get the new Pope's papal name.
Okay, I don't think we can lay it out any clearer for our viewers, and we will have the distinct advantage of George's translation, and then, of course, we'll get the first visual of the selection of the conclave. If you are just joining our live NBC News coverage around the globe, it is 6:21 p.m. in Vatican City. We've been on the air for just under 30 minutes when we had, for the second time this day, the first wisps of smoke. It became copious amounts of smoke from the chimney atop the Sistine Chapel. Various news organizations pronounced it flatly black, while most of the watching world was highly skeptical, was willing to go gray, if not totally white. And it turns out the bells have been ringing since. They have not stopped, proclaiming to all within earshot, and of course, by extension, all listening and watching in the electronic community, we have a new Pope. We are awaiting the opening of those doors on the balcony and our announcement. Vatican Radio has long ago confirmed what we already know to be true, that a new Pope has been elected, and shortly there will not be a remaining spot on the ground in St. Peter's Square, except for that area cordoned off by Vatican City Police. Lester Holt, I know crowd predictions are always a dicey business, whether it's the mall in Washington or Central Park in New York or where you are, St. Peter's Square. Do you care to hazard a guess as we prepare to, the bells have stopped ringing and we'll prepare to watch the window very closely?
Yeah, I can't tell you a number, Brian, but from my vantage point, I can see people still coming down the streets, just pouring their way down the street. Some of the rooftops, people have popped up on rooftops. Those bells proclaim the news, as you say, that there is a new Pope. At lunch today, there was a couple, a family from Oklahoma City, where you are, Brian, that stopped me and recognized me and said, you know, we're on vacation. We were supposed to go up to Milan and had some other stops, but we've stayed here because we want to see the announcement of a new Pope. And I said, well, I hope you'll be here this afternoon. Perhaps, you know, there's another session going on. Perhaps you'll witness it. So I've got to think that family is probably down there somewhere among the thousands right now, witnessing this event. Keep in mind, you see these young faces. Many of these young people weren't alive the last time this moment occurred. It is a moment of history, and I don't mind saying it certainly brings a chill down your spine and strong emotions to witness the scene of great joy after the scene of such sorrow we witnessed here just 10, 11 days ago.
And rosary beads we see in the crowd are being put to good and active use. The faithful have lined and in some cases stormed the barricades. And Lester, you point out the difference in mood when we were last there, of course. So somber, the saddest gathering and the largest human gathering on the planet, as the population of Rome, which hovers around 4 million normally, was doubled to approximately 8 million as a stream of people from around the planet did what they had to do, did what they could to come to Rome and pay their respects to a giant of the last 100 years on the planet Earth, Pope John Paul II, now buried in the crypt beneath the basilica. George, I know there is an interim stop in a place they call the Room of Tears. This is after the robing, where the full weight and majesty of the title often bears down hard on the man who is the new pope. Where are they likely to be physically right now?
That Room of Tears, Brian, is in fact the sacristy where the new pope puts on the white cassock or soutane and sash and skullcap for the first time. And it's called that because, as you say, many men have first realized the weight of the burden that they're taking on. As I was describing this yesterday, this is a man, whoever this is, who has just completely abandoned his own life. He's never going to go to a restaurant again. He's never going to go out to a movie again. He's not going to go to a concert or a theater. His vacations will be dogged by paparazzi. He's given up his whole life for the church. Where they are now, I expect, is somewhere between the Sistine Chapel and the Hall of Benedictions.
And as you mentioned, among the very first acts of Pope John Paul II was to shunt aside protocol and not have a seat and go forward to the railing. It really is largely up to the new head of the Catholic Church, what protocol has followed here. The crowd is reacting to another flutter of the curtain we see just behind those doors. They're looking for any clues at all, George, that we might have something.
The second piece of protocol that John Paul II broke, Brian, as many remember, was to give that little impromptu speech that Lester mentioned from the Central Loggia of St. Peter's. The historic custom had been for the Pope to come out to give his first apostolic blessing, urbi et orbi, to the city and the world, to wave a few times and then to retire back into the basilica. John Paul II, aware of how traumatized the church was by the rapid demise of John Paul I, and keenly aware of what the election of a non-Italian pope had meant for the people of Rome and the people of Italy, took the occasion to introduce himself in about three or four brief paragraphs, including a little modest put-down of his own Italian competence, which of course was quite terrific. And by the end of 3 or 4 minutes, he had them. He had become their bishop, he had become their father, and he proceeded on to the apostolic blessing from there. Whether the new pope will follow that custom, we don't know. Sorry.
And George, when you and I were last together, you were so struck by the incredible number of Italians who had taken the time out of their lives to queue up in astounding numbers, and you traced it back to that early show of humility and humor, and saying to the Italians who have judged popes in the past, non-Italian popes, by their embrace of the Italian language, by saying, if I get anything wrong, you'll correct me, in effect.
That's right. He did say exactly that, and he said, this son of Poland who has come from a far country is now a Roman. As the next pope, whoever he is and wherever he is from, will be. This is a city that feels its relationship to the papacy very, very deeply. There has been a curious sense of emptiness almost in the air here. It was raining ever since the funeral of John Paul II, almost as if Rome was crying over the period of a week. And now you see this crowd, which is not merely Roman, but as you see from the flags, from the Czech Republic, from Ireland, from Portugal, from Brazil, from Colombia, from the United States, from Poland, these are people who want a spiritual father again, and they're about to meet him for the first time.
It is a far cry from the, I guess the record was 2 years, 9 months, 2 days, back in 1271. We've been at this all of 2 days. This was the second session, and it was the timing that was so curious and led people like George Weigel to believe that if smoke was appearing when it did, about 36 minutes ago, that we may have, in fact, a new pope. The papal flag has been flying steadily over the Vatican as all eyes now are on those curtained doors. Father Williams, there's also, as Catholics will now digest the news and greet and welcome the new pope, there is the Catholic Church structure to think about. Obviously, this choice of the College of Cardinals, will have quite a job in front of him.
He will indeed, Brian. I think that the fact that the Cardinals came to a consensus around a man so quickly sends out a very positive message of unity from the College of Cardinals, which is a very hopeful message for Catholics everywhere, that there's great unity around a man that the Cardinals feel confident will do a good job in leading the church, and that kind of encourages everyone to take a very hopeful view of this man, whoever he may be.
And George Weigel, we are coming off a very conservative pope who reigned during an era when, as he constantly complained, Western values went against the teachings of the church. What exactly is the pendulum theory of the papacy?
I don't think that pendulum theory is going to be in play in this moment, Brian, because it was rather accurately, I think, and widely reported last week that the cardinals within 3 or 4 days had come to a broad consensus on the needs of the church and the church's mission in the world. As you understand, but perhaps some of our viewers may not, the Catholic Church does not reinvent itself with each pontificate. The pope is the custodian of a tradition. He's the servant of a tradition. He doesn't invent the tradition. And so I think we'll continue to see the Catholic Church take a forward position in defense of human life. We'll see the church continue to insist that human dignity is built into us. It's not something that's ascribed to us by the state. It's not something that's a function of our income or our competence or how beautiful we are or how successful we are. There's an innate dignity and value in every human life. The church will continue to press for the moral roots of democracy, so strong to John Paul II, that only a people who can govern themselves from within are capable of self-governance. Those are some of the themes I would expect to see spill over from the pontificate of John Paul II to the pontificate of whomever it is we're about to meet as pope for the first time.
We saw, while George was speaking, what looked like a flutter of activity behind these two most widely watched French doors in the world today. To no avail. We have not seen them open yet, and we will keep our cameras, of course, trained on them. But it would be in line with the traditional schedule if in the next few minutes now we had an appearance, an announcement, and Catholics worldwide learn who will lead their church in the years to come. George, how it was a youthful Karol Wojtyła. So much was said about how vigorous he was when he took over the papacy. Is there and the I guess we can call him the favorite of so many, Joseph Ratzinger of Germany, 78 years old. How much does age in this kind of election come into play, especially following the death who was in the death of a pope who was in such frail health for so long?
I think the cardinals very quickly recognized Brian, and perhaps this was driven home in an unmistakable way at John Paul II's funeral, that there was no duplicating this man. There simply was not a duplicate available, and it would be foolish to look for one. So I think the questions turn to a different set of criteria. Whom do we trust? Whom do we know? Whom among us do we entrust with the task of keeping the Catholic Church on a steady course, proclaiming the faith and its integrity, listening to the people of the church? These cardinals are men who have to do a lot of business here in Rome in the course of their lives. They want a pope who will listen to them and to the needs of their people in a sympathetic way. So I think those kind of criteria, rather than age or nationality or race, were the criteria that brought us to what appears to be a very quick resolution of this electoral process.
And a good reminder that not all popes serve as long as Pope John Paul II did. We mentioned there are many people visiting Rome, and for those in the city to bear witness to this moment is a once-in-a-lifetime experience. NBC's Jim Maceda has caught up with a family from the States. Jim?
I don't have any IFP.
Jim can, we can hear Jim, but he can't hear us, and we'll try to establish communications. He's right in the thick of it there in the middle of St. Peter's Square. Another man we have, you'll hear the crowd reaction to those curtains fluttering and opening. Just 6 inches difference will throw the crowd into a frenzy, believing the windows may be about to be opened. And we'll stay on that picture. Archbishop Foley is with us. Archbishop, your reaction to the news today and what this unlikely time of the election of a new pope could mean.
Well, of course, I had just gotten home and I was looking at television because I had instructions from NBC, as soon as there's white smoke, get back here. So I figured when there was smoke at that hour in the afternoon, it would be white, even though people were expressing doubts. So I got into my car and raced right over. I came right by the Vatican. People were running into the middle of the street, so I was lucky not to have killed some of the people of God on the way getting here. But I think it was most important that I get here, and I certainly tried to avoid them, obviously. But I was surprised that there was a decision made on the fourth ballot, and I think that's wonderful, because it indicates a consensus behind a new pope and not a long and divisive conclave. So I'm absolutely delighted and, of course, like you, eager to know who the new Holy Father will be.
Exactly the point that Father Williams made earlier, Archbishop, that this the message, this election on a by any standard, early ballot will send to the church as a whole. You know that we've heard over and over again from Vatican analysts using the old English language expression, tough act to follow, when you talk about Pope John Paul II, such a towering figure that made this choice so important. Do you agree?
Absolutely. And also, I think it's important that it was a choice made within a few ballots. It's understandable that the first few would not be conclusive because of the fact that there were people who knew others whom they esteemed and for whom they wished to vote and thought truly worthy of the papacy. But it's obvious that there was a consensus regarding this most important decision in the life of the church. And I'm sure our late Holy Father was interceding for this as well, because I have no doubt that he's with God, and I have no doubt that his successor will call upon his intercession, ask him to assist in the direction of the universal church, because it's a grave responsibility, and like you, we're all waiting to find out who it is. You might be able to hear some of the noise in the background, horns and sirens, and as I said, St. Peter's Square is jammed, and people were racing down the streets by foot, running with their little children. It was something I've never seen before, actually. It was inspiring.
We do indeed hear the sounds of Vatican City and the Rome metropolitan area, and as you were on your way, the crowd, Archbishop, cast their vote very early on that it was indeed white smoke, while all the while we had at least two major news agencies reporting that what they saw was black. So a disagreement there, and the crowd won. NBC News correspondent Keith Miller, who covered so much of the papacy of John Paul II. Keith, so much has been said about the personal qualities of that man, which will just have to go down as unique. An enormous mistake, I guess, for a new pope would be trying to be another John Paul II.
There will be no other John Paul II, Brian. It's an impossible act to follow. And I would have to say that the new pope, whoever he is, will be judged to some degree by what JP II was able to do so well, which was communicate his faith. There have been other great popes who have not been great communicators. John Paul II set a new stage for that. We're seeing that actually today with all of these people coming here. This is actually, Brian, drama of the highest caliber. The admission is free. It's a little bit crowded, but these people are here. Oh, we've got a good sound.
Here we go, Keith.
We've got a movement. Yep, we've got a movement all the way through.
George Weigel will provide translation. Cardinal Medina will make the announcement to the crowd.
Fratelli e sorelle carissimi.
Dear brothers and sisters.
Queridísimos hermanos y hermanas.
Dear chers frères et sœurs.
Now in French, the same. Dear brothers and sisters.
Liebe Brüder und Schwestern.
Now in German, dear brothers and sisters.
Dear brothers and sisters.
The English language.
I announce to you a great joy. We have a pope.
Eminentissimum ac reverendissimum Dominum, Dominum Iosephum. Sancte Romanae Ecclesiae Cardinalem Ratzinger.
Catholic Church.
McFarlane has just fainted.
The 265th Pontiff.
Benedicti Decimi Sexti.
Benedict XVI. Pope Benedict XVI. Cardinal Ratzinger is known to have a great devotion to the Benedictine order, the foundation of Western monasticism. Often goes to Benedictine monasteries for retreats. Takes the name of one of the diplomat popes of the 20th century, Benedict XV, the pope who guided the church through the First World War and attempted to be a mediator in that great struggle.
George Weigel, our Vatican analyst, while we await the appearance of Pope Benedict, go ahead and take us through the life of this 78-year-old dean of the College of Cardinals. What is known about Joseph Ratzinger, the man who admittedly has garnered most of the media attention in the days leading up to this vote?
Brian, let me just read you a story from Cardinal Ratzinger's Pope Benedict's autobiography or memoir of 1998. He explained...
We're just seeing the...
This is the papal coat of arms being laid out onto the loggia here. I think we would expect Archbishop Foley, these would be the arms of John Paul II, obviously.
I would think so, but I can't quite make it out yet.
They're having a little, yes.
Yes.
That's a distinctive coat of arms of John Paul II, Mary at the foot of the cross, M beneath the cross of Christ.
The Swiss guards are taking their positions.
Brian, could I return to Pope Benedict's memoir
a
moment? He was asked why he had taken Cardinal Ratzinger, a bear with a backpack on its back, on his coat of arms, a curious heraldic signal. And he explained that the bear comes from a legend in which Saint Corbinian, the founder bishop of Freising, reprimands the bear for tearing the bishop's horse to pieces on its way to Rome. And as punishment, the bear is made to carry the saint's load to Rome. Ratzinger saw in this an image of himself. He had chosen the life of a scholar, but God had chosen to make him into a draft animal, the bear that becomes his donkey against its will. Isn't that an image, Ratzinger asked, of who I am and what I should do? I have carried my load to Rome and have now been wandering the streets of the Eternal City for a long time. I do not know when I will be released, but one thing I do know, that the exclamation applies to me too. I have become your donkey, and in just this way, I am with you. That tells us something about the humility of Pope Benedict XVI. Joseph Ratzinger was born in Bavaria in 1927, I believe. Educated in seminaries there. His older brother, a priest, was a famous choir director in Regensburg in Germany. Ratzinger was one of the youngest professors of theology in the German university system, a major figure in drafting the central document of the Second Vatican Council, subsequently a professor at numerous universities in Germany, called by Paul VI to be the Archbishop of Munich in 1977 and to Rome by John Paul II in 81.
The red curtain is being held shut. You see the cardinals have gathered on the adjacent balcony or loggia next to it. And in the square, the reason for the vacant rectangle held that way by Vatican police, the Swiss guards, and the band taking its position.
Yeah.
Pope Benedict XVI. Apparently be hearing from the new Pope.
Cari fratelli e sorelle,
dear brothers and sisters,
dopo il grande Papa Giovanni Paolo II,
after the great Pope John Paul II,
i signori cardinali hanno eletto me,
the cardinals,
un semplice, umile lavoratore nella vigna del Signore,
humble worker in the vineyard of the Lord.
Mi consola il fatto,
I am consoled,
che il Signore
by the
sa
fact
lavorare e agire,
that the Lord
anche
knows
con strumenti
how to work
insufficienti,
and act even with insufficient instruments,
mi
and above all,
alle vostre preghiere.
I put myself in the hands of your prayers.
Nella gioia del Signore risorto,
in the joy of the risen Lord,
del suo aiuto permanente andiamo avanti,
and with his permanent help we go forward.
E Maria,
the
sua
Lord
Santissima
will
Madre
help us, and Mary, his most holy mother,
parte
will be on our side.
Grazie.
Thank you.
Thank you. Procediamo alla benedizione.
Let us go forth with the benediction.
Santi Apostoli Petrus et Paulus,
may the holy apostles Peter and Paul, in whose authorities and power we place our trust, may they intercede for us before the Lord.
Precibus et meritis, Beate Maria, Semper Virginis,
merits of the Blessed Ever Virgin Mary, of Saint Michael the Archangel, of Saint John the Baptist, and the holy apostles Peter and Paul, and of all the saints, may God Almighty have mercy on you, and after having forgiven your sins, may Christ just lead you into eternal life. May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant you pardon, absolution, and remission of all your sins, a time of true and fruitful repentance, a heart always well disposed, and amendment of life. The grace and consolation of the Holy Spirit, and final perseverance in good works. And may the blessing of the Almighty God, Father, and Son.
Amen.
And may the blessing of the Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Joseph Ratzinger of Germany becomes Pope Benedict XVI, a message of humility to the assembled crowd and a global television audience. He turned 78 years old last Saturday. He was last seen by that global audience delivering the homily at the funeral mass for his friend Pope John Paul II. The Associated Press calling him a guardian of doctrinal orthodoxy, elected the new pope Tuesday evening in Rome, where we are 4 minutes away from 7 p.m. This is the second straight non-Italian pope to lead the Catholic Church. And there is great celebration, no doubt, in Germany. On the telephone with us from the Pope's hometown, Martell, in Bavaria, is NBC's Martin Savage. Martin?
Hello, Brian. There has been celebration. The bells of the small church here at St. Oswald, the Catholic church in the center of this very tiny town, have been ringing continuously now ever since the announcement was officially made. People have been running around. This is a town that's only about a population of 2,700 people here in Bavaria, and there is a great deal of excitement on the streets. People seem to have been caught a bit unaware. They knew that, of course, the selection was going to be made, but they weren't exactly sure how they were going to react in this small town, because it is going to bring such dramatic change. They know from this point on that the man who was born here, that was known as Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger and now Pope Benedict XVI, will forever not only transform their community, but will bring notoriety, will bring pilgrims from now on. It will just not be the same as small town. You watch people running all over the square here. Inside, we were in the local brew house watching, the only place where you could see this on television. Spontaneously, old men and women broke into tears of the realization that their dream of Cardinal Ratzinger being Pope perhaps a few minutes before the announcement was too great to be realized. And then the moment it was announced, it was so greatly and emotionally received here. It is still a sort of sense of commotion and pandemonium here, Brian, as they try to fully understand the changes and the great joy that they feel. now that a man from their town has been elected to such a high honor. Brian?
Thank you, Martin Savage. And Germany just now getting a dose of the feeling that swept Poland with the announcement of John Paul II. This is the first German pope since the 11th century. And let's get reaction now from Archbishop Thomas Foley as the Vatican bells ring again, marking the 7 o'clock hour. Archbishop John Foley, I'm sorry, forgive me, I'm reading the word Thomas. We've known each other for years, which makes it even more embarrassing, Archbishop.
But isn't it a wonderful moment? And by the way, on the balcony with the new Holy Father was an American cardinal, Cardinal Schocke. I can't see all of the cardinals because of the glare. There was also, there is the Cardinal of Turin, the Cardinal of Warsaw. But it's a wonderful moment because Cardinal Ratzinger is such a warm, kind man. I've dealt with him over the past 21 years here, and whenever I've gone to see him and about a document or something, he has always been most gracious, understanding. He listens. He understands. He's just a model priest. And I'm very delighted with the choice of Cardinal Ratzinger. I was fearful that he might not be elected because of his age. But I am delighted that he has been elected because he has truly been a humble, faithful priest, archbishop, and cardinal as the leader of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, and before that as Archbishop of Munich. And he was a great theologian. I met him briefly during the Second Vatican Council, but I can't say I knew him well by any means at that time. But I have gotten to know him since, and he has been outstanding.
There you see some of the other cardinals. Archbishop John Foley, our friend of...
Yes. Okay, thank you, Brian. I won't keep you longer.
Oh, no, thank you. Our friend of many years at NBC News, Jim Maceda, is with some of the people who've now witnessed this great moment in St. Peter's.
I'm on. Brian, if you can hear me. Brian, if you can hear me, the camera is just swinging around ever so slowly, just to give you a taste of the movement now of people back and forth. I'd like to talk right now, if I could, with three American students. You're all from the University of California Extension. You're on your junior year abroad here. And if I understood correctly, Katie, you have lived through all of this emotion from the first day.
Yes, it's just been a crazy, frenzied whirlwind of emotion. It's amazing to live through. It's very emotional, but it's nice to know that it's kind of culminated and it's at an end now. It's time to rejoice, which is nice.
I noticed all three of you were clapping very, very loudly. First of all, when they announced that there was a pope, and secondly, when they announced that it was Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, who is now Benedict XVI. Carolyn, what was your feeling when the announcement came?
It was just so overwhelming. I know nobody can hope to surpass the greatness of the past pope, but it was amazing for him to, in his opening words, make that remark himself. And I think everyone's just anticipating another great Catholic pope.
Apparently there's some connection with Joseph Ratzinger, now Benedict XVI, that you have a relation. Is that correct?
One of our professors, Dr. Father Philip Lowry, is a priest here in Rome, and he is friends with Cardinal Ratzinger, and so he had discussed him in lecture several times.
Shauna, let me ask you, you seemed, of the three young ladies here, the most emotional. I saw tears running from your eyes and down your cheeks. You were here now since April 2nd, the night that Pope John Paul died, and you've gone through the funeral, through the masses, and now this. How can you describe what that feels like, living perhaps the experience of your life?
It's really difficult to articulate in words, but it's electrifying. Chills are just running down your body. It's one of the most spiritual experiences that I've ever underwent, and just I feel like I've been enlightened to the historical, the past, the accomplishments of the past pope, and I've really learned a lot and experienced a lot, and I feel so privileged to have lived through history and to have been in Rome in this moment in particular. I will never forget it.
Ryan, that's it. Three of many, many reactions here. Three young ladies, Americans, who have certainly something to tell their children and grandchildren. Back to you.
Jim Macedo with those terrifically well-spoken and very excited students from the United States in St. Peter's Square. Before we go to Lester Holt for some closing thoughts, George Weigel, it strikes me that, first of all, the luck of it is that the Catholic Youth Day is scheduled to take place in the Pope's native Germany this summer. Perhaps for our viewers who've heard the news and are tuning in, a paragraph on the kind of Pope Benedict XVI, the former Joseph Ratzinger of Germany, will be.
He's going to be a different personality than John Paul II, as he himself acknowledged in presenting himself to the crowd. This is a shy professor who has learned to be a public personality, who will radiate a kind of quiet holiness and integrity rather than the more ebullient style of John Paul II. This is a man who is going to take the conversion or reconversion of Europe very seriously, beginning, as you say, Brian, with World Youth Day in Germany this coming August. That's the kind of man I think we're going to have, a man of quiet, humble, deep piety, brilliance, and unflappability.
Fong.
You're watching Lester Holt in Vatican City as the bells continue to ring, and anyone who thinks that this Pope will budge the line in the sand on moral issues did not hear his homily yesterday as Cardinal Ratzinger at the mass leading to the conclave. He talked about having a clear faith based on the creed of the church, often labeled today, he said, as fundamentalism, whereas relativism, he said, which is letting oneself be tossed and swept along by every wind of teaching, looks like the only attitude to today's standards. And he says we're moving toward a dictatorship of relativism that does not recognize anything for certain and which has had its highest goal, one's own ego and one's own desire. Not a politically correct statement for one who would hope to be Pope. Or the words were, we have a Pope, Pope Benedict XVI, and the celebration continues at Vatican Square, at the Vatican City, and across the world. For Brian Williams, I'm Lester Holt, NBC News. More coverage tonight on Nightly News.